Step in the game, here to bring the heat. Texas 22, we on the beat. Leo and BT hosting this show, talking X's and O's. We letting y'all know, Texas 22, breaking it down. Podcast got the city vibing to the sound. Special guest dropping out, it's so true. Houston Texans, damn, this one's for you. Texans 22, breaking it down. Podcast got the city vibing to the sound. Special guest dropping out, it's so true. Houston Texans, damn, this one's for you.
Hey guys, welcome to another episode of the Texans 22 podcast. As always, I'm your host, Brown Chubby Bear, a.k.a. VT. I've got my partner in crime, Leo, a.k.a. Leo is Forgiven, a.k.a. The Run Game. And this week, we have our special guest, Seth Payne. You know Seth Payne. You probably wake up to him in the mornings, just like most of the people that are watching here on the Seth and Sean Pendergast show. We watch it all the time on Sports Radio 610. Payne and Pendergast is pretty much one of the shows that almost every single Texas fan that I talk to watch. I'm very happy to have you as a guest on the show, Seth. Let us know. How you doing today?
I'm good, man. I like the intro. That was impressive. That was I got to up my game on my own YouTube now. I feel like an amateur, man. I'm feeling good. It's a weird vibe amongst Texans fans. And I guess it's not weird. It's new, that everybody's like universally excited. And I feel like 97% of Texans fans trust Nick Caserio, which is the unique thing. Maybe since Nick has come in, that this is the first year where I feel like headed into the draft, despite the fact that a lot of people are upset at not having, or at least would prefer to have a first round pick. They trust Caserio. If Caserio tried to trade out of the first round last year or the year before, it would have been absolute mayhem. I think this year he's built a certain amount of trust to where people are just they're taking a wait and see approach to it.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because during the infamous 610 wars, as I call it, between, you know, with all the shows going after each other for a period of time, people really questioned what was going on in free agency. We have spent $145 million, right? We've added players like Daniel Hunter, Al Shazier, Joe Mixon. So in your mind, has Caserio really done enough at this point?
I don't think he's done enough, but that's not a criticism. I think it's just that it's a constant work in progress. I think right now he's very much sitting and waiting. And, you know, one thing about Nick is he's very flexible. I don't think he goes into any offseason or any draft or any free agency period with a rigid idea of like, okay, we're going to get this, and we're going to get this, and we're going to get this, because you just never know exactly how the market's going to actually unfold. So we knew going into this free agency period that, one, he was going to have to spend a lot of money on lesser names just to replace the guys that were leaving or, you know, needed to be re-upped. So we knew that a good chunk of the cap space was going to be taken up with that. I think after that, we talk about this a lot. All right, what if they had signed Danico Autry and then traded for Eric Armstead versus signing Danico Autry, bailing on the Eric Armstead trade, and then getting Danielle Hunter? I feel like in a weird way, people are more excited about the Danielle Hunter signing, as they should be, than they would about an Eric Armstead. But there is a certain incompleteness to the free agency right now that you didn't address the two departing defensive tackles or make an upgrade over those guys. So like, that's the part that, you know, these unleft, unchecked boxes like defensive tackle, starting cornerback, which I know Okuda and Henderson will be vying for that. But, and, you know, interior offensive line, I didn't expect them to do anything, but it still would be nice if they did. And then obviously wide receiver, where they went after Keenan Allen. So like we know by their actions that they're not finished. You know, if they went after Keenan Allen, it's likely that there's maybe not that wide receiver out there in free agency right now. Maybe there is one via trade, but certainly in the draft, that's going to get filled somehow, some way. Maybe Keenan Allen was the last the last guy out there in free agency or on the realistic trade market that they can get it right now. But that's where I am. I'm like, I'm pleased with what he's done. I think he filled in a lot of holes, but you still have the draft and the remainders of free agency to fill in some of these spots.
Right. Well, there's still a lot of time left. There's obviously UDFAs as well. So there's a lot more that he can do. But we freed up $16 million in cap space. And as you said, it's not done yet. What are you expecting him to do?
Okay. So originally, as soon as they cleared it, I thought, okay, this is a big trade or something. And, you know, Hassan Reddick ended up getting traded to the Jets later that day. Obviously, like, I don't think Hassan Reddick was what they cleared the space for. It was either going to be a free agent. In my mind at the time, it was either perhaps one of the remaining free agents who would command a big 1 or 2 year deal, like an aging Stephon Gilmore or something like that. Cause I think that's where they are right now with their veteran players. They certainly don't want to give anybody more than a 2 year deal. So clear up a bunch of space right now. The other immediate thought was a trade, you know, I don't know, Brandon Ayuk or T. Higgins or something like that. And then the third and maybe more realistic option, but not exciting at all, is that, all right, there's Steven Anderson. There are guards out there on the market. There are all these guys, kind of nondescript guys that can fill in holes, but aren't necessarily going to command a huge bunch of money, but they'll soak up. You know, we've seen how it goes. They could soak up a bunch of money real fast. So I think that's probably the most realistic. And like, again, I'm okay with that at this point. The biggest letdown is just that there's not going to be a first rounder that you feel like, oh, okay, this guy's going to, at least as of right now, there's not going to be a first rounder that you can get super excited about immediately. The flip side to that is that, okay, that you can get really excited about pretty much any of the wide receivers that are going to be available by the time they're at 42. There's a few defensive linemen. I think the interior offensive linemen, as you get further into the draft, get really, really deep. So my disappointing and boring answer is I think they're probably ultimately going to use that $30 million on filling in some holes, but it's probably not going to be a blockbuster name unless some trade materializes and you know, Nick might be just thinking that too, that, hey, they're open to trading for a T. Higgins or a Brandon Ayuk, but sometimes that stuff doesn't happen until right before the draft or during the draft.
Okay, fair enough. Leo, you've been a big Caserio supporter, even when I questioned him. So tell me your thoughts on if Caserio has done enough, and what do you expect Caserio to do with the $16 million that he got from restructuring Tytus Howard and Shaq Mason?
I think Seth kind of made a bunch of really good points there. I don't really know exactly what he's going to do, but I know that there seems to be like one or more plans working at once, and one of them will end up happening. You know what I mean? So that's kind of what I mean. You know, we do kind of have like, you know, some definite, I guess, like holes that, you know, can be filled by adding more depth. And that's kind of what I think is probably going to happen. It might not, that stuff might not even happen until after the draft, you know. Has he done enough? I mean, to this point, I say so, because, you know, you don't really, it's not that many teams that, especially coming from like where we were, you know what I'm saying, the past couple of years, you know, without having like, you know, multiple draft classes that where, you know, he's already, the GM has already, you know, decided who he's going to retain and give second contracts to. You know what I'm saying? Like, we aren't in a spot to like really have a full roster going into a draft yet. So I think up to this point, man, I think it's pretty much like as good as it could be when you look at how deep we are on the edge. And I do think that we got better on the interior D line in some ways. You know, I can understand why people feel like it's not complete though. But I think, like, man, you know, up to this point, I think it's about as solid as it can be, you know what I'm saying, before the draft, you know?
I think,
Go ahead.
I just saw one of the comments about trading for Derrick Brown. And, like, I would love that, Derrick Brown, the defensive tackle from the Panthers, because I know what you're saying about the interior defensive line. I do feel like they've plugged in. For one, Denico Autry can rush from the inside. I think they got a bunch of other grinders, and I think Khalil Davis has got upside there. But, like, none of them are quite the impact that Eric Armstead was. So that's where I feel like, okay, they were going after Eric Armstead for a reason, and Derek Brown would be that guy. I don't think that the Panthers are going to trade him. I think that they said goodbye to Burns, but then after that, they're like, all right, no, this is a young stud we've got to keep. So that's where, like, the fact that they were going to trade for Eric Armstead was the one thing that just kind of like the attempted trade for Keenan Allen makes me feel like that's where Nick probably still feels like the hot spots are.
All right. So you mentioned that one of the positions that we need to fill is corner. And I actually think that the secondary is our worst position group right now. Last year, we gave up 230 yards per game through the air. Stingley's really the only baller that we have. I love Petrie. I think he had an excellent rookie year. I think they should move him, though. I don't think that he's good as a deep safety. Ward has gotten hurt. There really is not another DB out there that's reliable. And even Stingley himself has injury concerns. So do you think that the secondary is the worst position group? And do you think that the Texans are going to resolve it in free agency? Do we have to wait in the draft? Or do you think they're really happy with Okuda and Henderson and we're not going to see many changes there?
I think, boy, you know what? I hadn't really thought about whether it's the worst position group because a healthy Derek Stingley kind of maybe disproportionately colors the way I feel about the secondary as a whole. But you're right. I mean, there's just huge question marks with, Jimmy Ward and his injuries, Jalen Petrie, and just whether he's meant to be an NFL safety or not. And then obviously the guys opposite of Stingley. I guess my panic level isn't as high just because I think that there's still very much upside in Petrie. Could Justin Simmons be the guy though that they spend some of that money on? I'd be A-okay with them spending money on Justin Simmons. The cornerback position opposite of Derek Stingley is the one that needs to be filled. I guess I look at the free agency market and I look at what the Texans might want out of a cornerback there. And I'm not in a panic that they're not going to be able to fill it. So as of right now, yeah, I think it's fair to say that they're the weakest position group. I just don't worry about it. I don't worry about their ability to improve it as much. And I think Dez King as a slot corner in his second go around here. And perhaps, you know, with maybe D'Amico, it's interesting that they let him go and then brought him back. That there might be more there than people feel comfortable with Dez King. But I think they certainly need to bolster the defensive backfield. Even if they get all the starting spots right, they spend a boatload of time in nickel. I think that having three safeties that can play at the same time on the field in the modern NFL, if you're going to play dime with three safeties, you know, that's huge for this team, especially with some of the ways they've struggled with play action and tight ends. But yeah, I think that's fair. That's fair to say that they're the weakest position group as constructed right now.
Well, you had some good comments there, and this actually leads into a question that Leo had, because Leo had a few questions about the nickelback position specifically. Leo, do you want to ask Seth that question?
Yeah, so I'm reading this to make sure it gets worded right, so bear with me. All right, with more teams basing their offense out of 11 personnel, how do you think this has changed the nickelback's role and importance since you were in the league?
Oh, yeah, good question. I mean, that's where a lot of teams feel now that, yeah, your nickelback is a starting position. A lot of, you know, like on a lot of depth charts, they list the nickel defense as the starting defense. I think when you go to like the depth charts on PFF, they just go immediately to nickel. So that is huge. I think from my perspective too, what's changed is just how it affects the defensive line, and that guys who are first and second down players, don't get drafted in the first round like they used to, linebackers or defensive linemen, just because you never want a guy, you don't want to take a guy that high that an offense can just take off the field with a personnel grouping. And like, I don't mean to move away from the nickelback discussion, but it does bring up like Tavondre Sweat. I think Tavondre Sweat's the classic guy that, man, 15, 20 years ago, he would have gone in the first round. This go around, people are looking at him and they're thinking like, all right, man, on a long drive, if they're stuck out there in nickel or dime and Tavondre's out there, it could be trouble. So So on that side of it, certainly changed. I think with the defensive backfield, the nickelback position is yes, for sure. I think then also, though, this is where, you know, a guy like Jalen Petrie, these safeties who have man cover skills, you know, Jimmy Ward when he was younger, I think those guys are more valuable than they've ever been. Mm-hmm. And it's ironic because they still view safeties kind of like they're these commodities, unless they're like the true studs out there. And that's where I think that with the defensive backfield, I'm trying to keep an open mind as to like who they draft, what kind of veterans they're going to use. And really with Derek Stingley at the end of the year, tracking Amari Cooper and them showing a willingness to, you know, maybe have him travel with the best receiver, it kind of opens up a lot of windows to, all right, that second cornerback can be more of a zone cornerback because the Texans are going to play a bunch of zone anyway. And that's why Steven Nelson, in some regards, actually, even though he doesn't have the name brand appeal of a Stephon Gilmore or Xavier Howard, like one of Nelson's best abilities is to play off coverage and then break on the ball. He has really good sense for when to come up. And that, like, I'd love to have Steven Nelson back. Dez King, I don't know if he's your A number one, like first choice of the guy that you want to trust, you know, all the time. And yet he's been capable enough. That's where drafting a defensive back in the second round, I don't think it hasn't been a really popular choice, has it, in a lot of the mock drafts?
Not really.
It depends on who you ask, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. It's a, like, I wouldn't be surprised if it's a defensive back. Mm-hmm.
So, of course, let me just say this, though. Of course, every single time when I mock draft, I'm mocking a corner at 42, and I get so much hate for that. But I'm so really – continue with your question.
You kind of brought up something, too, that I thought was interesting, talking about Tavondre Sweat. But I also kind of feel like these edge rushers that also, like, are just pure sub rushers, guys that actually have, like, base 4-3 builds,
yeah,
that have upside to even play weak side edge or even be as effective rushing the passer as a sub rusher, I feel like, are also at a commodity now. You know what I mean? Also,
like Denico Autry.
Yeah, right.
You know, we can play inside, can play outside. Right. Charles Amenihue was the same thing. Like, I think it's ironic. I feel like Denico Autry might be kind of like the guy they had hoped Charles Amenihue was going to become. Charles Amenihue ended up going to San Francisco and playing for D'Amico. You know, and obviously that's not going to happen. But, those guys are worth maybe way more than they used to. And then the tricky thing with defensive tackles right now, like if you look at, obviously Byron Murphy and Johnny Newton probably aren't going to go to the Texans. They'll be too high. But if you look like Braden Fisk and Chris Jenkins as two guys in the second round that don't have ideal size, those guys, I get nervous for what the Texans would draft them for and what they could provide if what D'Amico really wants is a guy that's going to be a stud versus the run. Mm-hmm. Because like those guys are classic, man. If it works out, they could be awesome pass rushers. They could be versatile, but they're like, you know, 295 to 305 pound guys that it's hard for me to project them being genuine studs versus the run. Whereas with Tavondre Sweat, like, yeah, I know he can rush the passer for a certain number of downs. Right. I get really nervous. I get nervous that he seems to be just fine weighing 365. You know, like at the combine, he was just like, nope, this is me. This is who I am. And then I watch some of the plays, man. He kicks ass, but then there's plays where, whether it's run or pass, he'll be like 5 yards away from a ball carrier and he can't get there, you know, because he's tired. So that's a point. But when he's kicking ass in a hardcore way. So you're kind of stuck there when you're looking at these defensive tackles in the second round. They're like, all right, none of these guys are really swinging a lead pipe or anything, but they could become really good pass rushers. Just, I don't know exactly where D'Amico's head is on that right now.
Yeah, true. All right, so this is the last one. So Jason Braddock, you know, had charted out basically how often we were in, you know, 4-3 and nickel and all that. So, okay. Do you think that was like more so like preference? Like D'Amico wants to be in nickel, or is it because he wasn't really fully comfortable with his three linebackers on the field at the same time?
That's a really good question. I think that, for one, yeah, I think maybe not total comfort with the linebackers at times, and then just flat out injuries at times too, where they just, I mean, there are a couple games there where they only had two viable linebackers. So on a game by game breakdown, you know, I wonder how heavily it's skewed to a few games, but yeah, I think that if you looked at last year's team and looked at perhaps where he thought that, where he could get speed on the field or where he had the most talent, it just worked out that way some ways. And then I'm trying to think of the matchups. I don't think the matchups were necessarily anything where they were going against teams that were 11 more so than any other team in the NFL. It's funny because D'Amico's got old school tendencies in a lot of ways, especially like in the way that he wants his linebackers to play. The one thing I love about D'Amico is that he plays this defense that's all about getting upfield and pressuring with your front four. And a lot of times defenses like that, and I know you guys have heard me talk about this before, but a lot of times defenses like that, they have the philosophy of playing the run on the way to the quarterback. But like D'Amico is like, that doesn't fly with D'Amico. Like he wants those defensive tackles to be able to anchor down versus double teams and to do a lot of the grunt work like that a lot of aggressive defenses don't necessarily do. Because of that, you also got to have some genuine studs at linebacker though. When you're playing super aggressively off the edges, you're funneling everything in, and then those linebackers have to both play their pass coverage responsibilities and come up and fill versus the run. Like you got to have some super stud linebackers to do that. And including like your Sam's got to be way better in coverage than a lot of Sam's might typically be. You know, I think that's why he likes Alshire so much, was because in San Francisco, he could play Sam, he could play Mike, he could play Will. So I think, yeah, there's a good chance that last year, whether they were healthy or not, he never really had, it wasn't that often he had three linebackers that he felt really good about those guys in coverage. And then it's just a matter of, all right, we gotta try to stop the run somehow, some way. And they did, at times, you know. And then there's times like the Colts game where they were just atrocious versus the run. And it's a really good question, Leo, because, you know, I've been shying away from saying that they might take a linebacker in the draft because I feel like they really like Alshire, obviously. I think they like Will a lot. And Christian Harris. And I think that, but it might also be that they really would love a guy that can come in and play Sam really well too. And maybe it's not Henry Toa, and they don't know who it is right now.
Right. Yeah.
Well, we're going to talk about the receiver room, and there's been a couple comments about the offense. And I just want to address that real quick on why lately you may have seen, like in the past couple of weeks, I've been focusing on the defense. Honestly, last year, in my opinion, the offense was pretty good. Now, I'm not saying it was perfect. We had a banged up O-line. We really only had one player that was playing this natural position that wasn't injured throughout the season. Even Tunsil was injured. The only player was Shaq Mason. Other than that, everyone was either a backup player, not playing in the natural position, or injured. So the O-line had a lot of reasons why, when people talk about the Jets or the Ravens game and why we didn't score a lot of points, a lot of that was O-line. Obviously, you had Tank Dell out for 7 games as well, and we lost 7 points on average per game when you lost Tank Dell. Nonetheless, we know that we have to upgrade the receiver room. And we have met with quite a few receivers. Seth, my question to you is, are we now looking for a slot or wide receiver 3? We had Nico Collins, who had 1,300 yards and eight touchdowns. I just mentioned what happened to Tank Dell, and he was on pace for over 1,000 yards before his injury. What type of receiver are we looking for? Because some people are saying that we need a wide receiver 1.
Right. It gets really tricky in the modern NFL when you start talking about who is a slot receiver, you know? Because obviously like Tank Dell is the guy that you look at and you're like, oh, that's a slot, right? Like, no, he spends most of his time on the outside. So I wonder if if you start talking about wide receiver 1, wide receiver 2, I think that Nico and Tank are fine as a wide receiver 1 and wide receiver 2, whichever, you know, by game plan, who's the number one, who's one, who's two. I don't worry about it as much. I think that when it comes to looking for a slot receiver, Keenan Allen would have been a great guy who, especially as he's aging, spends a lot of time in the slot. He'd be perfect. He's a guy who can't play on the outside, but he can spend a lot of time in the slot. He can be that guy. I think if you get into the draft, if you're picking in the second round, that's when all of a sudden, you know, I don't think it's a slam dunk necessity that the Texans would say, well, yeah, we want a guy that's a slot guy. But when you're in that second round, sometimes the best value are the guys that would be X receivers, except they're too small. So they're slots, you know, like, so they're, you know, I think Ladd McConkey will probably be on the out, like a Ricky Pearsall or something. You take those guys, not because you don't want a huge wide receiver one type looking guy, but because you're in the second round and the guys that might be most viable are those smaller guys. So I think that's what they might end up with. But I think that realistically, they could take any guy that it doesn't have to be a guy that projects to be just a slot receiver. I think that if they do take a guy that projects to be a slot receiver, I think it's because they think that's the best receiver available at that spot. If they're a trade back up into the first round or something, you know, I think they would 100% be looking for a guy that could play any position in the wide receiving core. Does that make sense?
It does. I mean, you're basically saying they're looking for someone that's flexible. You know, the reason why I ask that question is because I think some people don't believe yet that Nico Collins is a wide receiver one because of his first 2 years here, which he, you know, didn't even have 500 yards, right? And he had 3 touchdowns his first 2 years. But I think you saw him with 1,300 yards and 8 touchdowns with C.J. Stroud and really being a wide receiver one, 195 yards against the Colts. I don't know how you can say he's not a wide receiver one in my view.
Yeah, you know, and I think part of this too, I'd paraphrase Mike McDaniel, I guess, you know, when they're asking him questions about whether Tua is actually good or is it just the weapons around him? And he basically said, who gives an F? There is a little bit of that. I don't want to compare anybody on the Texans to Tua Tagovailoa. That's a whole nother discussion. But I think when it comes to like, all right, well, is it Nico or is it the scheme or is it the CJ so good? There's a part of me that just says, all right, well, I don't really care. Like, I think that Nico is going to produce regardless, as long as he stays healthy. The biggest thing that I'm excited about with Nico, and I'm glad you brought up the first 2 years when he was injured, is when a guy all of a sudden does stay healthy, is there a reason behind it? You know, did he change something with his routine? And he did. And, you know, he's talked about how he learned all those lessons from those older guys. And over the course of this first couple of years, he realized like how much he had to implement in the off season. It's kind of like when Carlos Correa figured out the regimen he needed to do to keep his back healthy. And all of a sudden, lo and behold, Carlos Correa started staying healthy. I feel confident that Nico's going to stay healthy this year relatively. And that's really the only question mark in my mind. So I'm totally comfortable with him. I think though, as far as becoming a potent offense, if you look at like maybe what they ideally would want to be versus where they can go right now, they've got one genuine tight end. I like Brevin Jordan, and I hope that he continues to look like he did towards the second half of the season, you know, and I hope they can use him creatively. But he's kind of a tweener, you know, and if you don't have a couple tight ends that you can trust, then you better have an extra something somewhere else. And I think that's where the Texans might want to be more heavily of like almost transitioning more towards a Sean McVay in his first couple years in the Rams type of offense. And I think that, you know, you hear McVay talk about that, you know, everybody just expected McVay to do exactly what they had done with Kyle Shanahan. He got to the Rams and he's like, oh, we've only got really one good tight end and we've got all these stud wide receivers. All right. Cool, yeah. So like this year in the draft, look, there's not many tight ends. There's a ton of wide receivers, free agency, not really any tight ends. There was a Keenan Allen available via trade.
Well, Leo, I mean, you heard what Seth had to say, and you just did a video with Josh about 3 receivers that are going to be available in the second and third rounds and possibly later. So so let's hear what your answer is. I think Seth made a great point when we say, like, are we looking for a slot? Well, we're looking for a player that plays both inside and outside, and then you have game-specific scripts. But let's talk about like different players that you like. I know you, like I said, you just did a video on it. So talk about some of the players that you want to like to see on the squad.
I also kind of I'd include tight ends in there too, also Seth, because I would love to hear your idea on this. To me, I kind of feel like, so you have two guys that basically can play on the outside. I don't really care whether the third major weapon, you know, outside of how you view Dalton Schultz, if the third pass catching option is a receiver like Javon Baker or like Roman Wilson, but if it's also a guy like a Benson Sennett, I know this guy will never be there, but like a guy that can basically is like a fringe receiver and like Brock Bowers. I mean, just from your playing experience and like playing in defenses and watching football, like how difficult is it when you have a slot receiver like you kind of reference, like Cooper Kupp, like the Cooper Kupp type of guy that could come in and almost block as if he's a move tight end, but then you have like these tight ends like Aaron Hernandez and like, you know, just Kelce and Laporta now, like which one do you think is more difficult to game plan against and stop, you know?
It's a really good question, because obviously it's going to depend on what your personnel is defensively. But like I still think, and this is where I think that Gronk's not going to age well in comparison to Travis Kelce when I think in the history books and everything, because people don't realize the fix, like the bind that Gronk put defenses in, because they had to figure out. I mean, it was Kelce. They know what Kelce does not make any defense second guess whether they can stop the run or not with Kelce in the game. You know, they're like, no defense is saying like, well, no, we got to keep our regular defensive personnel group in because we got to stop Kelce. Like, no. Where with Gronk, it was like, all right, well, do we keep our base personnel in or we go to nickel? If we keep our base personnel in, they're going to kill us with the pass. If we go to nickel, they're going to kill us with the run because Gronk can run block. So I think like that's still the ultimate bind, is if you have genuine stud tight ends that can block and can pass catch. For me, I think that the thing that holds me back on that, though, is that if you look at C.J. Stroud and what he could do with a really good, savvy slot receiver like Keenan Allen, where you've got this quarterback who just, you can tell, he just sees and processes the game extremely well. And, you know, like defensive players won't shut up about like how advanced he is with all of that. That's when, you know, Tom Brady became a different type of quarterback when he was unable to unlock like Julian Edelman, right, and figure out exactly how to just find the weak spot on a defense. So I think that, and I'm honestly, I hadn't really thought about this. This is a really good question. So I'm kind of thinking my way through this. If I'm rambling, I apologize. But I think for CJ, yeah, that three wide receivers can be that much more lethal. You know, that's it crazy. Just, man, yeah, like you can pick and choose like how to attack a defense with CJ controlling the chess pieces. Yeah, I like that.
That's pretty sick.
Yeah.
I want to address this real quick, and thank you, Scott, for providing a super chat. And he's saying that you should enable them, and I really think you should. Okay. But let's address this question, which is Malik Washington. Do you have any thoughts on him? Do you think that he would be a fit here?
I think I gotta be honest with you, like any of the fast dudes, I'm like, yes, I need him now. Yes, that's the guy. I watch them run through zones in college, and I'm like, oh yeah, hell yeah. Give me any of these guys. This is where, and I'll be honest, I'm really bad around draft time because I'm not Lance Zierlein, obviously. Like, I'm not sitting there pouring over tape after tape. So I try to focus on people's positive aspects. And when it gets to guys like Malik Washington, I'm like, yeah, hell yeah, of course I want him there. And I part of me just trusts, I have to like trust that hopefully the GM and the coach know what the hell they're doing in drafting the guys. And a lot of it comes down to like with the big 30 visits, and you guys had pointed out, how many of the big 30 visits for the Texans have been wide receivers so far?
Eight
of them already. Yeah. I think a lot of it really comes down to like the way obviously that their coaches and teammates talk about them. But how they do on these visits, like they want to see that there's a fit and a vibe and a feel like that. Okay, we like the way this guy thinks about football and that he understands and he can criticize himself for mistakes he may have made and all that stuff. A lot of it ends up coming down more to that than anything you can see on film.
All right. I want to get to stay on offense a little bit. And this is about a comment that you made on, I think, one of your last videos. And it's about left guard position. So yeah. You spoke about Dalton Risner. And my question to you is, why don't we have him yet? He was going to get paid like $3 million. What's the reason why he's not on the squad?
I think with Dalton Risner, he might fall into the energy vampire category. And I say that with nothing. I know nothing except that he got in that altercation on the sideline 2 years ago in Denver and then had an injury, sat out in free agency forever until Minnesota signed him. And then he played pretty well for Minnesota last year. Like he started within a week or two. And like, so, but he's another one that perhaps I think that, for one, maybe there's a personality mismatch. And I say maybe he's an energy vampire. I have no idea other than that there was like some spectacle there and he sat out for a while. I'm trying to figure out, like, what do you think they really feel about Kenyon Green? Like, do you think that Nick thinks that, all right, this guy's just had really bad luck with injuries and that if he's healthy, then there's really something there? Or do you think that he's way more nervous about it than that?
I mean, I think he's more nervous. I think that you got the injuries, but you also have a poor performance. And then you also have his personal issues, which obviously you can't fault him for having personal issues, but that's part of the reason why he hasn't been able to really be who he needs to be. At the same time, you're in a situation where you have CJ, a top five quarterback, playing with a top eight receiver, an offensive line other than him, that's really been paid to, you know, the highest in the league at this point. Yeah. He's really the odd man out. So I think at this point it's like, well, Kenyon Green, you're a top 15 pick, but if you're not going to work here, we got to move on. And I think they want to give him a shot, right? I don't think he's like a Bill Belichick where he's like, with a snap of a finger, you're off my team. I think he does like to give dudes a shot, but I don't think Kenyon Green has taken the opportunities he's had. And I know that might sound harsh because he's had those injuries, but despite those injuries, I don't think he's taken that opportunity. A lot of people have said that when he started camp, he started not being in the best shape that he could have been in. And so there are still discussions on whether or not he is really NFL ready. So I think they're nervous about him.
Yeah, and I think that if you look at just, I mean, the revolving door they had to go through at left guard last year, unless they feel that Patterson was that promising. I know Kendrick Green did way better than I expected him to, because when he was in Pittsburgh as a center, he was just, I mean, it was one of the worst things I've ever seen. Like I went back and watched his, what were supposedly his best games out of Pittsburgh. And it was really, really bad. So when he stepped in at left guard and actually did reasonably well, I was kind of shocked. So I was like, this is a lesson learned on my part, but I don't think you look at him as a guy that's going to be a full-time guard in the NFL. I feel like they've got to do something about it at some point. And maybe it's one of those veterans that's still sitting out there on the market. I think Connor Williams is still out there. There's still a few guys. Like there's guys out there in the defensive backfield and in the interior offensive line that I feel like maybe they're just either waiting for the draft or they're just haggling a little bit over smaller stuff. I'd expect to see one of those guys at some point sign in the next couple months.
Well, this question is to both of you then, and continue talking about offensive linemen. With the amount of investments that we made, and like I said, most in the NFL, not to mention draft capital, but obviously in cap space, could you see the Texans actually drafting a lineman in the top 100 this year? Or do you think that's not even in the cards?
I think if it was – or sorry, go ahead, Leo. He's asking both of us.
Well, I was just going to – I had a short answer. I was just going to say, why stop now?
Yeah. I know we've got – we don't have a first round to spend on one, but there's – how many first rounders do we have invested on the first line? And we got two in Laramie. We got one on Titus. We got a second rounder in Scruggs. So, yeah, between first and second rounders, then, go for it. I think that is – it's the fact that the Texans don't have a pick in the first round in this year's draft doesn't hurt as much because it's so wide receiver and so offensive tackle heavy that, I mean, and you might have 15 offensive players go in the first 15 picks. I don't know. I feel like the guards and centers are probably a little bit later, but maybe that second pick in the second round. And I know people feel that there's a lot of really good interior offensive linemen, just not necessarily first round type guys. I wouldn't be extremely surprised, but I also, I guess this is where I get nervous on relying upon any draft strategy. You know, I'm not Bill O'Brien. I don't hate rookies, but I don't trust them. You know, like I don't trust a draft pick until he shows up and plays. There's a part of me that when you sign a veteran free agent, even if they end up being a disappointment as a free agent, you can still trust them. Like, even if like, there's a thing of like, there's a way that a veteran can be a bad football player, but you can still trust him and rely on him having like a consistent effort. Whereas rookies, sometimes it's just, they're going to get destroyed. If you can't trust them, they're going to get destroyed and they screw up your whole day. Especially on the offensive line. I'm thinking of the Cowboys game 2 years ago when I think it was Kenyon that pulled the wrong way on the goal line. Like that's the prime example of when a rookie just ruins your whole life.
Right, right. Leo, do you have anything to add about us adding offensive line in the top 100? I know that you think that perhaps they should, right? Like, I mean, what's your argument there?
Well, I mean, it just hasn't been good enough. I mean, I don't look at our line being dominant. So, I mean, if there's a guy that you feel like can help protect your quarterback, man, and, that's the most – important part of the game is making sure that your quarterback is upright and being able, you know, and you do that by protecting them and being able to run the ball. So it's like, if the value of the player is equal to or worth more than the pick, I think it's definitely worth drafting one. I mean, regardless of how much of an uproar it would cause, you know, I just kind of feel like, you know, you can't go wrong drafting good players, man. It's hard. It's hard to just draft good players.
You're more of a like the Ravens are the best at just taking best player available, whether they have guys there or not, or no matter what they've done in the past. And sometimes it looks weird, but like more times than not, it works out. Yeah. I think the other part of the offensive line that I worry about, just because I've been pretty confident about this, is that I'm still pretty confident in Juice Scruggs working out as a center. Despite his struggles at guard, I look at him, and especially like sometimes there's some really good centers that when they play guard, you can see exactly why they're good centers. It's just something about the body type and the way he moves and everything that I feel confident that he's going to work out as a center, but he hasn't shown it yet. You know, we really don't know that. So when you've got two question marks at center and left guard with some promise in Patterson, you know, and Kenyon Green, just who knows exactly physically how he'll be. That's the part that makes me nervous. But I wonder, you know, whether they go best player available or not. I think that one of these bands of players that Nick talks about trading back into, I feel like for offensive line, there might be a band of players in the third and fourth round that they trade back into.
Third or fourth. Okay. All right, so this will be the last segment we do. Cowboy hero with a fighting spare. All right, so the segment's really called Would You Draft Them? And basically, these are three players that have something not necessarily wrong with them, however you want to word it, but they're not the ideal player. However, they're going to be should they be a rebel? So these are the scenarios. The first one is Ennis Rakestraw. Ennis Rakestraw, he's a cornerback. He's from Missouri. And now the scenario is that he drops. He's available at 42. Now, we've talked about that we do need help in the secondary across from Stingley. The problem is he's had an ACL tear. He's separated core muscles. He's had a groin injury. He's had various other soft tissue injuries. He's only had one interception in the past 3 years. He's a better zone than a man corner, though you said that actually would work here for us. Now Stingley having injury concerns as well. Do you draft a corner knowing that he's had not as much as many concerns as Stingley, but damn near close? Would you draft him at 42?
The thing I like about Rakestraw is that like he is a tough, tough, tough competitor. And I know like there's no question about his toughness or anything like that, but it's also aside from his physical injuries, like sometimes that toughness shows up in being extremely handsy. And I worry that, okay, is this, is he kind of like a Lonnie Johnson type where like he can't, and a young Lonnie Johnson, because I know Lonnie Johnson has been working at it. But man, like between the injuries and whether or not he can play the way he did in college, but refine it to where he's not so handsy because he's going to get flagged for it in the NFL. That makes me nervous. And I was looking over Stingley's stats before we came on, and he played 400. It was fewer than 500 snaps this year. You know, so he still hasn't had a complete season as a player. So the injuries, I try not to label guys as injury prone, but the injuries scare the hell out of me right now. So I'd be nervous to take another potentially injury prone cornerback.
That's my concern as well. Leo, are you concerned about Rick Straw's injury history? Would you draft him if he was available at 42?
I mean, when I watched him play, I haven't really done a real deep dive on him, so I didn't really know his injury history was as extensive as you had told me before the show. So, I mean, it's definitely scary, but I mean, he plays so well. It's like it hurts to have those negative thoughts, you know, about a talent like that. But it's kind of scary. It is scary, you know.
It's scary because our other corner has those injury concerns, right? So, like, I mean, there's a situation, God forbid, we draft him and both our starting corners are down, you know. So that's
plus, I'll be honest with you. I get scared of the core muscle. Any core muscle thing, this goes back to Benny Joppru. Because, like, Benny Joppru, second-round pick in 2003, a tight end out of Michigan. He was going to be so good. I can't tell you guys like how awesome he was in practice, but he had like, he was the first person I'd ever heard of a sports hernia. And then he had all kinds of core muscle issues after that. And like, ever since then, I've been very nervous about anybody when they get a core muscle injury, whether it's JJ Watt or Adrian Peterson or anybody else like that. I've got a sensitive spot there.
Yeah. I hear you. The next person on this list is Jeremiah Trotter. Now, the scenario here is that he's available at 86. What's the concern here? His size. Yeah. He's only 6 foot. He's 228 pounds. He has 31.5-inch arms. He's good against the run. He's good in coverage. His father, when he played, was 6'1", 262 pounds. So you have the genetics there. You could potentially think, okay, the genetics are there. He could gain another 15 to 20 pounds. You know, if he's 240 or something, then he's pretty much good to go. But his size right now may concern you. Do you take him at 86?
I wouldn't take him at 86. I think that for right now, you like what you've got at Mike and Will. And I don't know how they feel about Henry Toa Toa, but like D'Amico's going to want to develop guys. I keep feeling like N'Kobe Dean keeps popping into my brain. He obviously went higher, but he was an undersized guy in an awesome college. And like, I get nervous about undersized dudes that are awesome in college. It's a projection, you know? Right. So for where they are right now, it would depend on how they feel about Henry Toa Toa, but I'd have to pass right now. I hate to be sizist, but I'd pass right now.
I feel you. I mean, Leo, what do you think?
Yeah, I kind of agree with Seth on this one about like that. I mean, and then another thing too is he didn't really test, so you wonder like how much of an athlete is he? Because I think the smaller you are, the more athletic you kind of have to be to kind of be successful. He didn't run a crazy three cone. He didn't jump, and you know everything else was just kind of like he had a good 20 yard, I think, but like 20 shuttle or whatever. But I mean, like you know. A guy like that that is undersized is supposed to just murder the combine, you would think, and he didn't test. So I'm kind of – it makes you kind of wonder how athletic is he.
Yeah, you know what? And that's the thing where D'Amico's obviously the guy you lean on for this stuff. But with linebackers, their ability to recognize and diagnose is just – that's so – it's so hard to define sometimes and recognize it. Like for him – They might look at him as a guy that, man, you pick him up in the fourth or fifth round, but he's got that some little extra something to him. And I think maybe that's what they were thinking with Henry Toa Toa, because athletically Toa Toa is not, you know, there's a reason he didn't go in the top rounds. But so I'd be intrigued by that, but I don't think as high as in the 80s.
Right. Okay. So the last player on this list is Michael Hall. Now, the scenario here, he's available at 59. Now, as far as tape is concerned, he got destroyed by Michigan's O-line. And go blue. I'm a Michigan fan. So when I saw that, that was kind of, you know, discouraging because I know a lot of people are mocking him to us. Now, he's 6'3". At the combine, he was 290. Apparently, at his pro day, he did get up to 300. So, but that's still undersized. You were getting bigger up front. You know, we signed Foley, and he's 318. We're signing dudes that are really 310 and above, closer to 320. Would you draft him at 59, knowing his size concerns and knowing that when he faced bigger competition, literally and figuratively, bigger competition, that he couldn't hold up?
Yeah, that's you know, that was one of the concerns with Will Anderson, was just how he did versus some of the big NFL dudes. And one of the things that was interesting about him, I grew less skeptical about Will with some of that, because when he worked inside, size wasn't an issue at all. So like when he lined up in a 4-eye technique, or, you know, sometimes 3 technique, or when he was slanting down inside, he handled the bigger guys pretty easily, and he used his hands really effectively. It was when Will was on the outside just rushing as a pure edge rusher that he was kind of raw, and like he tried to go speed to power a lot sometimes versus bigger guys, and it didn't work out. And you saw him work at that this year and get a lot better at it. Like, there was so – in the second half of the season, there were so many fewer instances of him just kind of locking horns with offensive tackles who were big. So I think with guys like Hall, that's where the really tough part of being a talent evaluator and somebody who projects talent is, all right, do we look at Hall as this guy that's going to be able to use his quickness to figure out how to neutralize these guys? Because like he'll fight his ass off, you know, but he just sometimes just he struggles to get off the block when those guys engulf him. That's where taking him in the second round would scare me. Like, it feels more like, okay, this is a third round guy. This is a guy that if you're a little bit more polished, I'd feel good about taking him in the second round, but he's just not quite there yet.
I am 100% in agreement with you. Leo, what do you think?
Man, you know, I'm gonna just go against the grain on at least one of these. I'm gonna say yes, you know, screw it. Like, yeah, I mean, I think he has, you know, he has long arms, he has big hands, and I think he's athletic enough to kind of play a little bit of strong side edge possibly as he develops and stuff. And so I think, you know, I think him adding 10 pounds and still testing the way he did, like he had a crazy 10 yard, he had a crazy, like, 3-cone, I think. So I think that, man, you know, there might be something there with him. But at the same time, like, it definitely wasn't – his play wasn't consistent. You know what I mean? He flashed a lot, and then there would be games where he was really quiet. So I definitely understand why you wouldn't want to draft him that high in the second, you know.
And it's hard, man. Like, this is what I hate about the draft season. It's like – it's I every year I've been in this business, like in the sports media side of things, I have more and more appreciation – for just what a crapshoot it is for guys that like spend this whole, like they spend so much time watching these guys and analyzing them. And there's like a lot of these scouts are brilliant dudes, and yet you're just going to whiff on a lot of them because you don't know until they get up there. And some guys just figure it out, and some guys just fail immediately. And like all these defensive tackles in the draft this year, I love the way all the guys in the top three, like I don't look at them like, okay, if we go to just the top five or six, Byron Murphy, Johnny Newton, Braden Fisk, Tavondre Sweat, Chris Jenkins, Michael Hall, like those guys, they play their asses off. You know, they're not bums and they're not lazy. Tavondre Sweat plays his ass off. He gets tired, but that's physiological more so than like, it's not like a lack of toughness or anything. And right. That's what's really hard, because you see the upside on all of them, and this is where the coaches' visits end up really, really mattering. Like with Tavondre Sweat, I'm super curious just exactly how D'Amico and or Nick talk to him about, you know, like how he feels about how's he going to handle all the guacamole in Houston, you know, like, well, like these kinds of things they concern me.
All right, guys, I want to thank the 300 people that have been watching this episode. This is really fun. Seth, can you tell us anything on what you have planned for tomorrow morning show?
Oh, tomorrow morning's show. I haven't checked what show. You know what? I'll tell you right now. I'm going to go to our show prep. And I'll tell
I'm
you
sorry
what
to put you on the spot there.
No. This is, well, because obviously, like, I'm gonna go. I know Altuve hit a home run right before we came on here. Let's see. Sean is typing as we speak. Ryan Poles did another interview detailing how calm and amazing he is. So, I tell you, Ryan Poles gets so much credit for sucking and passing on CJ Stroud, and yet, like, it turned, like, every move he makes, people are like, wow. He did it. He really did it. He managed to suck again. Look at this. So we'll be talking about that. We've got Aaron Rodgers' performance-based pay. He's putting all the fun stuff in right now. And we've got the pregame video from George Springer. So probably a lot of Astros tomorrow.
Gotcha. All right. I really want to thank you for jumping on. This is great. I think we learned a lot. I'm going to make some clips and I'll tag you in. So hopefully everyone will enjoy the information that you were really able to tell us today.
Oh yeah. No. Hey man, I wish I had the gonads to tell you exactly what the Texans are going to do, whether I know it or not. But like this, yeah, this time of year, man, it's so much more fun right now than it was 2 years ago. So I'm just happy to be here. Thanks for having me on, guys.
Right.
Thank you very much. Thank you guys for watching. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel, Texans 22 Podcast. And just remember, Texans 22 always has your back.
Texans 22, breaking it down. Podcast got the city vibing to the sound. Special guest dropping knowledge so true. Keep the Texans down. This one's for you.